everyone, and welcome to Daily Newspaper Analysis, which is brought to you by Lossico. So today we will discuss three articles, but since two of them talk about the same topic, so we have mixed them together. The first one is from the Hindu newspaper, which is titled as, "Will the new e-commerce rules really favor the consumers?" And a similar article we have in the Indian Express as well, which is titled as, "E-commerce next steps." So this article talks about the new e-commerce rules and what can be the big takeaways that we can have from these, and will the consumers at large be really favored through these e-commerce rules or not, shall be discussed here. The second article is from the Hindu newspaper, which is titled as, "The Laws for Surveillance in India and the Concerns Over Privacy." So this again has a touch of the issue of Pegasus, but again, this talks about the laws that we have in India through which the surveillance can be allowed. If you remember, in our previous discussions, we talk about the various agencies that are allowed to do the surveillance in the country. Today, we will discuss that what are the laws that are important and that can be used for such surveillance. So this newspaper analysis is presented by me. My name is Sheva Khan. I am a law graduate and had completed my law degree in the year 2019 from Uttaranchal University with a gold medal in my batch. Here at Lossico, I'm working as the manager for current affairs vertical. And if you wish to connect with me, you can find me on my Twitter as well as LinkedIn handles. The links to both are available in the description box below. So let's see what is the multiple choice question from yesterday's discussion. The case law Shionandan Paswan versus State of Bihar is related to, your options are compensation, camera trial, custodial death, or public prosecutor. If you know the answer, put it down in the comment section below. This is the descriptive question for the day. What are the various surveillance laws in India? List a few. So if you wish to download the PDF of today's slides or you want to get another kinds of study materials like our monthly newsletters, monthly quizzes, daily quizzes, etc. So you can definitely be a participant in our Telegram channel. The link to this channel is also given in the description box below, or you can simply scan this QR code, which you can see on your screens right now. Also, if you do not have a lot of time to watch the analysis and you want to bring it on the go and you want to have the podcast of the same, so I'm delighted to tell you that the podcast is also available as Daily Newspaper Analysis by Lossico on various platforms like Spotify, Google, Anchor, and even Apple Podcasts. So you can check that out too. Also, for other crisp and important content, do not forget to follow us on our official Instagram channels, which are for Judiciary, CLAT Prep, and UGC Net, if at all you are preparing for any of these exams. With this, let's get started with the first article of the day, which talks about the new e-commerce rules. As we know that the Union Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution has recently come out with a list of proposed amendments to the Consumer Protection Act 2019. We know that very recently, the Consumer Protection Act 1986 was amended in 2019 to have the Consumer Protection Act 2019, wherein e-commerce was also added to the purview of the Act. And now the Union Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution has again come up with a few proposed amendments to the 2019 Act as well. So the central government has set up Advisory Council for Open Network for Digital Commerce, which is the ONDC, to digitize the e-commerce value chains. So basically what happened was that during the time of 2019 and even till date, specifically if you talk about after the pandemic, we have seen that the people's reliance on the e-commerce. Guys, what e-commerce is? Basically, it is simply when we use any technology, any electronic device for any kind of selling or buying mechanism. Like, for example, we are buying something from Amazon, Flipkart, eBay, Nykaa, Purple. There are a lot of websites. So whenever we are paying them with something and we are getting some kind of product, this is a simple example of e-commerce. So definitely in today's times also, normally as well, and specifically keeping the pandemic in mind, we have been more and more relied upon the e-commerce websites for various basic commodities as well. And keeping this in mind, this proposal or amendments have come up from the Union Ministry in this regard. Now let's discuss in further detail that does the particular draft that we are talking about in here about the e-commerce rules really favor the consumers or not. So firstly, the draft is very complicated and the intent is not clear. See, to be very precise, the e-commerce simply being added to the purview of Consumer Protection Act was quite much enough, as it simply gave the consumers the power to sue any particular seller or any particular, you know, agency from which he or she was buying something if in case the product was defective. And thus, it already increased the ambit of the Consumer Protection Act. But when we're talking about this particular draft of the e-commerce rules, it seems to be a bit too complicated, and why or what is the real purpose of bringing in these new rules or amendments is not really clear. So one can be to prevent firms from taking over commerce, and the other can be to encourage Make in India, that is a flagship government scheme. Now, there are two things that we can possibly think of, that these could be the two possible aims or goals of these e-commerce draft rules. That the first one could be that such firms that, you know, if they are trying to take over the entire market through e-commerce, so such firms can be stopped so that equal competition can be maintained in the economy and the market. And the second thing that can be thought upon is can be to encourage the Make in India program, which is a government flagship scheme. And yes, of course, when we talk about the self-reliant India or Atmanirbhar Bharat, one scheme of the government is very, very, very crucial when it comes to it. That is Make in India. I am sure that when I'm speaking these words, Make in India, you must be, you know, able to imagine a big, huge lion that is made up of a lot of gear products, a lot of screws, and a lot of mechanical things, which actually signifies that we should be, as a country, be able to manufacture more and more, and we should rely lesser on the import from the other countries. And that is why when we talk about bringing in these e-commerce rules, so there is a better chance that this Make in India can be pushed further to better limits. Now, the second thing about these draft rules is that in principle, the draft rules are unnecessary. So this is also one contention. Now, please understand here that these are simple articles that are provided in the newspaper. It is you who has to make your own opinion, right? So you have to understand, think about the pros and cons, and then try to understand and make an opinion about it. Now, one opinion that has been presented in this article is that these draft rules were not really required. Now, the article says that e-commerce already have consumers. Now, when we talk about the e-commerce sites, so they already have customer care centers, competition, and other quality check consumer courts for fraud. Now, as I was just mentioning in the very beginning of this article discussion, that while in 2019 amendment of the Consumer Protection Act, e-commerce was added to the purview of Consumer Protection Act, it very much made it significant and evident that now the consumers, if at all they have any complaint or there any fraud has occurred against them, so they definitely can move to the consumer protection authorities and to the consumer protection courts as well. And that is why bringing in these rules exclusively does not really hold a lot of extra benefit as such. And the rules will increase the cost for e-commerce and add bureaucracy. Now, another problem that possibly could be one thing that might happen, that, you know, the system, the chain would increase, and the people who we have to report to, basically it will increase this chain in the middleman, or what we are saying, it will add to the bureaucracy, and hence there would be more and more chances of corruption and lesser justice being served. Also, the third thing over here is the fallback liability. Now, the fallback liability, it means that when we try to hold a Kirana store liable for selling us a washing powder that is defective. Now, for example, there is some washing powder that we bought from a particular shop, right? Now, if that washing powder is not able to clean the clothes properly, or it bleached out the clothes or something, who is to be held responsible? The shopkeeper or the real manufacturer? See, in the real terms, yes, it has to be the manufacturer, the company that was selling this particular product. And if at all we are completely blaming it on the shopkeeper or the owner of the shop, then definitely it is not justified. And maybe whatever additions have been brought through, or what they are being sought through these e-commerce rules, here this problem might arise, wherein the real person might not be held liable, and just there could be a fallback liability. So here are some rules to protect the consumers. Like, we should ensure that the consumers are not cheated through leaking of data, spamming, or deceptive advertisement, because many a times this also happens, that they show some other kind of product, they show some other measurements on the e-commerce website, and when the product is delivered, it is completely different. Or we should also regulate the monopolist. So if at all there is a particular seller, if at all there is a particular website that tries to create any kind of monopoly in the e-commerce market as well. We should stop that as well, because it will definitely be a hamper, or it will definitely be an impediment or an obstacle in a fair competition that we really are looking forward in the market. And thirdly, it should address a market failure. So there can be two kinds of market failures. First, there can be concentration of powers, and second can be information asymmetry. So yes, of course, concentration of power is somewhat similar to the monopoly that we are talking about. And information asymmetry is something that no proper information is available, or what information is actually required by the consumer, that will not be available. So that definitely is against the rights of the consumers, because in this situation, the consumer would not be in a position to take a good and informed decision. But here also is a positive side to these. Now let's look at that as well. So it says that if implemented properly, then it can level the playing field and create value for users. And thus e-commerce, it can also be, you know, something that can be definitely now in the current situation also, from shampoo to toothbrush, you can order the smallest things from the e-commerce websites as well. And that is why the system should be designed with three layers of open digital ecosystem. That is, technology should be there, governance should be there, and community should be there. So all should be brought into balance, and then we should look forward in the coming times. With this, let's discuss the second article for the day, which talks about the laws for surveillance in India. Now, we will cover this article in very short, because about this Pegasus, we have been discussing from quite a long time now. So we will specifically talk about that. What are the laws for surveillance in India? So firstly, we have the Telegraph Act 1885. So it says it deals with the interception of calls. Section 5 clause 2 of the Telegraph Act allows the interception or the detention of messages only in certain situations. So please pay your attention here. That it is not like that every now and then, or of every person here and there, we can tap the phone calls or we can intercept or detain the messages, but it is only possible to be done in certain situations. So proviso to Section 5 clause 2, the lawful interception cannot take place against journalists. Now, this is a very important point, because see, when we talk about the profession of journalism, the very purpose of having journalism is to bring out truth. Now, for example, I am a very corrupt leader. I'm a very corrupt politician. And I have a hint that this particular XYZ journalist has some kind of hunch against me. That person or this journalist has some information that can actually uproot me, or that can actually, you know, expose me out into the public. So it would not give me the power to tap the phone calls or the messages of this particular journalist, because this will ultimately bring down the very purpose of having, you know, journalism, and shall never, never, ever be able to bring out the truth in front of the people. And that is why lawful interception cannot take place against the journalists. Then the Supreme Court, in the case of PUCL versus Union of India in the year 1996, pointed out the lack of procedural safeguards in the provisions of Telegraph Act and laid down certain guidelines for interceptions. Now, as we know, that it is not the lack of laws or the improper laws that is the problem. Rather, the implementation, the poor implementation or unlawful implementation becomes a greater issue. So here, the guidelines became basis for Rules 419A in the Telegraph Rules in 2007 and also the Information and Technology Rules of 2009. So the next law that we have for surveillance in India is the IT Act 2000, which is the Information and Technology Act 2000. So this act is there to deal with surveillance of all electronic communications following Supreme Court intervention in 1996. So as we just mentioned, that the IT rules, which later came out, we also now have the IT Act. So this also helps in the surveillance of all electronic communications. And specifically, we talk about Section 69 of the IT Act. So it allows the interception, monitoring, and description of digital information for the investigation of any offense. Now, you must have seen, I'm very, very sure, that whenever we watch any of, you know, these episodes of like Crime Patrol, maybe Savdhan India as well. So what do they show? That there was a list that the police could take out, that where, you know, what was the location of the mobile phone of that particular person, if they have any, you know, doubt against that person, or to whom the calls were made, what messages were delivered, and everything of that sort. So yes, it allows interception, monitoring, and description of digital information for the investigation of any particular offense. Also, it dispenses with condition precedent set under the Telegraph Act. Yet again, it says that, you know, lawful interception cannot take place against the journalists. So this article also provides for a way forward wherein it says that the wide reach of these laws should be tested in courts against the cornerstone of fundamental rights. Yes, of course, because see, right to information also is a fundamental right under Article 19(1)(a). And that is why, if at all, how much this right to information can be given to a particular person. Right to privacy also, you know, plays an important role, which yet another is a fundamental right, is another fundamental right. So all of these things need to be put into balance. And that is why it says that the court, the Supreme Court, basically the courts in India, they should play this role of making sure that there is no overreach of any of these laws as well. And thus the truth and the justice and, you know, what we call as this entire truth, it actually triumphs and it wins alone. So yes, this was all for the day. We hope it was a good session for you all. If you liked it, do give it a thumbs up and please subscribe to our channels for never missing an update. Thank you so much.